Ouch! But at least he had a warm bath to look forward to at the end of the day.
When the first assistant director shouted, "Cut! That's a wrap!" there was this extraordinary rush. People sprinted to all the vehicles that were there to try and get back to the hotel because there was only enough hot water for half the crew.
Here we were out in Scotland, and it was cold, and it was wet, and it was sunny, and it was dirty, and it was everything, and it was really an unpleasant life for certain urbanites that happened to be living in the group. And where Terry and I wallowed in the mud, I'm afraid John Graham and Eric didn't.
John and I struck out for Pastors New. We found something called the Hydro Hotel in not far away, you know, about 20 minutes away. And we moved in there, and everybody was, "Oh, you're going to leave us all?" Said, no, we just want a hot bath, you know, gosh. And so we moved in, and as we got there, all these beautiful women just walked in and arrived, and we went, lucky, really. And they were in our movie.
Leading those beautiful women was Python favourite Carol Cleveland, a regular in the TV shows whenever a real woman was needed, instead of one of the lads in drag. Carol had featured in ITV series like The Saint and Man in a Suitcase before comedy opportunities came her way.
One thing to another, I found myself at the BBC doing a fair amount of work, being a glam stooge to people like Ronnie Corbett, Ronnie Barker, Spike Milligan, Charlie Drake, who used to have his little nose right there in my cleavage, I remember. Well, then the Pythons heard about me.
Carol was great. I mean, Carol was, within Python, she's the only woman we ever had that just seemed to be able to get the comedy and be beautiful and fit in with everybody else. No matter what we did to her, she just sat in there beautifully.
I remember saying to my husband at the time, well, I don't know about this show. I don't think there'll be more than 5 episodes, actually. And how wrong I was, happily.
Castle Anthrax was, I wrote, of course, because I was determined to get some sex in Python for once.
Welcome, gentle Sir Knight. Welcome to the Castle Anthrax.
The Castle Anthrax?
Yes. It's not a very good name, is it? Oh, but we are nice, and we will attend to your every need.
You are the keepers of the Holy Grail?
The what?
She was really terrific in Castle Anthrax. I mean, just had that right sort of attitude of slightly dominating, but a little bit sort of enticing at the same time.
Zoot was a lady who was in charge of a huge number of virgins aged between 16 and 19 and a half.
Well, I remember how incredibly unsexy it all was. You know, it just seemed wonderful in the script and all that, and all these girls would be on the bed and they'd be sort of, sort of caressing you and all that.
They're doctors?
As always with filming, you know, anything like that gets reduced to a sort of a job. It's a bit like sort of mending the plumbing or something like that.
Dr. Piglet, Dr. Winston, practice your art.
It was far from being the wonderful full-on orgy that I'd, expected when I wrote it.
Try to relax.
Are you sure that's absolutely necessary?
We must examine you.
There's nothing wrong with that.
Please, we are doctors.
We had about 5 takes as he's being dragged away, and we're just there going, oh, oh, oh. And the final take, I just threw in at the end of it.
Shit!
And everybody laughed, and they kept it in. It was quite fun. My little bit of improvising in the film.
Look, my duty as a knight, sample as much peril as I can.
Now we've got to find the Holy Grail. Come on.
Don't let me have just a little bit of peril.
No, doesn't help
it. Bet you're gay.
No, I'm not.
There was tension in the air. It didn't seem like a happy company. The crew were very quiet and sort of looked a bit disgruntled. And I then discovered that the crew, in fact, were on the verge of downing tools. There was nearly a mutiny because they got so fed up with having these 2 directors who seemed to be at odds with each other.
2 directors, a double-headed dog. It was interesting because Terry and I seemed to be in agreement about everything before we started shooting. About life, the cosmos, everything. And as we started shooting, it was clear that sometimes we were saying opposite things to the others in the group.
It's a dog's body job, actually, directing. I think it's it really has just got to organise things and work out what you're doing in the morning. And it's a very thankless task.
We do tag team directing. And he finishes that, he'll come out here and exhaustedly tap me on the shoulder and I'll rush into action and away we'll go.
But, I mean, you're all treating him with proper respect.
Well... I mean, there's never been any mutual respect within the Python group at all, as you probably know, but we're withholding a lot of the criticism that we would normally be making.
Terry and Terry Gilliam, particularly Terry Gilliam, they were so enjoying the visual look of it and all that. And they sometimes had trouble persuading certainly someone like John, you know, that it was very important to crouch for... another 12 minutes so they could get the sun glancing off the top of his helmet, you know. He just didn't see the aesthetic value of that particular shot. He just felt he was very uncomfortable. But he is tall, and he's got, you know, bending down is probably more difficult for him.
The only thing that seemed to matter was the look of the shot. And I did a take with Eric where Eric was playing Concorde.
Come on, Concorde!
Message for you, sir.
Concorde, speak to me.
I want you to realise that when we're making a movie, you only do about three or four really good takes in the whole movie, was when it all flows. And we did one. I was so proud. I thought that was a great take.
Brave, brave Concorde. You shall not have died in vain.
I'm not quite dead, sir.
Well, you shall not have been mortally wounded in vain.
I think I could pull through, sir.
Oh, I see.
Actually, I think I'm all right to come with you, sir.
No, no, sweet Concorde, stay here. I will send help as soon as I've accomplished a daring and heroic rescue in my own particular...
Idiom, sir?
Idiom.
No, I feel fine, actually.
Farewell, sweet Concorde.
And I said, how about that? And the cameraman and Terry John said, not enough smoke. And that kind of incensed me, because I care about the writing, the ideas, and the performance. So from then on, I made a lot of sarcastic remarks about, was the smoke funny enough in that take, or, you know? So there was a bit of a tension between the people who cared how it looked and the people who were a little more interested in what the film was about.
I think the moment it finally snapped was when we were doing the scene where the taunters are pelting the knights with cows and sheep and everything over the battlements. It was a mat shot, so I had to get everybody below the parapet of the castle so I could then cut a mat out and throw these toy animals over later. And which meant digging a hole in the ground to get low enough, and the others in the group had to be on their knees to get all these angles right. John and Graham were the first to go and just got so angry with me for this uncomfortable positions I was putting him in. And it was, and I said, this is your sketch. I didn't write this sketch. This is your sketch. I'm trying to make it work. If you don't like it, I'm off.
I know that I was a bit mean to Terry Gilliam on one occasion, because Terry was used to doing animation and having these cutouts, and he would move the cutout a fraction and then move another cutout a fraction. And he had a tendency to treat the actors a bit like that. He would say, can you move just a little bit to the left? And we'd do that, and he said, no, back a little bit. And this would go on for 15 minutes. And once I think I sort of exploded. I said, will you get on with it? I was so uncomfortable, you know? And I think that hurt his feelings, poor chap. And he went and lay down.
So I went off in a snit and lay down in the grass some distance away. I'm not going to play. And Terry then had to deal with them. And I think that was the moment. Let's split it.
Terry Jones, I have to say, was always slightly more aware of the actors, being one of the actors, being involved all the time and having to, you know, do a bit of directing and then rush around and be Sir Bedivere and all that.
What do you find is the most difficult part of sustaining the effort?
Oh, sort of getting up, really.
In the morning?
Yes, and putting the clothes on.
It just seemed to me the comedy was going to be much more effective if you believed in that world, if that world smelt and you could taste it and it was there, and then you could do the most silly things within that and it'd give the comedy more weight, and I still think that's true.
You know, they really did a fantastic job. When you see that boat sweeping in, you think, oh my gosh, this is a proper movie. And then it goes back to being silly, but it's the properness of the movie which sets it all up, I think.